So, open for questions. Or are people so happy or unhappy with the fiscal compact that they have no issues they want to raise? Very shy bunch, aren't they, Joe? For those who haven't had a chance to read my writings on the fiscal compact, I suppose I maybe make a starting statement and say nobody can really object to the idea of having sensible, good quality macroeconomic, macrofinancial governance. The issue is whether or not this fiscal compact is actually something that will give us that, and if in doing so it will, in a sense, cause more trouble than it's worth. My major problems with the compact are, first of all, that I don't think it would have stopped the last bubble in Ireland, because it's simply about aggregate measures, and our difficulty was, yeah, aggregate measures were important, but also the composition of tax base. Secondly, it requires us to have agreement on something on which economists cannot agree, which is the definition of, and the measurement of, a cyclically adjusted structural budget surplus or deficit. There's significant implications in the figures that are put forward, significant implications for the sovereign bond market. At one level, having too much debt is a bad idea, but equally perhaps having too little debt might be a bad idea. I'm unsure as to whether this is the right way to do what we're supposed to do here. The other point I would make is that if you look at the FISC in general, it's about taxation, it's about expenditure, and it's about transfers. And at the moment, what we are proposing is simply a spending compact. It doesn't address the issues of whether or not we wanted to have any degree of control over taxation, and that goes back to my issue about structural composition of the Irish tax take over the last while, nor does it address the issue of transfers. And some figures I saw recently suggest that let's look at something in the US. People say, oh well, in the US the mechanism for the automatic stabilizer is that if people are poor in Oklahoma, they simply get up and drive and go to California where there might be jobs, or Montana or wherever. And yet through the operation of federal level welfare and other activities, and through the fact that the state tax systems and state budgets are somewhat interlinked with the federal system, in the US, if California or if Delaware lose a dollar in tax revenue, they get back about 40 cents of that through the operation of the automatic federal level stabilizers. We don't have anything like that in the European Union at the moment. So this is very much one leg of a three-legged stool, and I think we've got to take some time before we get the others. So that's my kind of potted concerns about it, and you know, I'm here to ask questions. So over to you. Hiya, George. Issue of common interest rates, different economic cycles. The thing is that what we're looking at is one of the fallouts of one monetary system, one monetary policy doesn't fit all. So the question is whether or not advancing beyond one monetary policy to one spending policy. It's one of these things that at the end of the day, if we want to have a European Union, and you know, there are different views on that, we're going to have to move towards much greater federal level involvement. Now, whether or not that means that we have one size fits all, or whether we have something more akin to the US, where we can have a degree of automatic stabilizers at the fiscal level put in place, I would prefer to see that. I'd prefer to see a more overarching approach where we have federal level or European level transfers, but that will only come at a cost of giving up more control over our taxation and expenditure. So, no easy answers there. Not sure if that answers your question, George, but I think this is an improvement in principle, but in practice, I'm not sure it's going to be something that will actually work. What's your feeling, George? Do you think this is good, bad, or indifferent? Or does anybody else have concerns about that? Yeah. Well, we mustn't forget that the European Union is ultimately a political entity. People keep forgetting the fact that the European Union is an outgrowth of a series of treaties, or treaties, as Enda might call them, which were designed ultimately to try and end war in Europe. So on that base level alone, between the major historical belligerents in Europe, it has been an absolutely outstanding success. Now, the European Coal and Steel Community, the European Atomic Energy Community, later the European Economic Community, were about tying together the European belligerents into hopefully such a cohesive economic bloc that politically they could never go to war again. And that has worked. The issue now is whether or not there is a will politically at the political level, or at the national level, or at the individual levels, or what the different wills are in order to deepen that, or do we want to say, well, maybe we went too far too fast. Yeah, this is one of the problems, George. I mean, under the Maastricht criteria, we were supposed to have had 3% budget deficits and 60% debt to GDP ratios, and yet one of the most interesting issues is that some of the worst offenders way back at the start were Germany and France. In fact, up until 2009, Ireland was in full compliance with the Maastricht criteria, and we would have been under reasonably full compliance with the new proposed fiscal compact, and yet we saw that we ended up with the ship of state on the rocks. The consequence, therefore, is that if you want to do something which will prevent that from happening again, you have to have more intrusive involvement if you're going to do it at a federal level. In other words, we'd have to have had a situation where somebody could have come in and said to Charlie McCreevy, said to Bertie, said to the Irish people who had voted them in power, no, you are over-reliant structurally on a boom, a bubble taxation system, and you must change it. That would be sold domestically as these terrible people from Brussels are telling us to increase taxes and to, you know, cut expenditure, and that wouldn't have gone down well. So yeah, it's politics. Any other queries on the policing or the politics issue? Or is everybody watching the match? I don't know, Joe, I think we'll go on and we'll have a cup of tea. What strikes me about the compact is that it has all the hallmarks of we must do something, this is a thing, therefore we must do it. The European authorities have had a year and a half to come up with an answer to the crisis, and they've been unable to do so. This is tinkering around the edges and has all the hallmarks of that. It's designed, we understand, to ensure that it doesn't have to be put to referendum in Ireland. And I'd be less confident than I was, say, a month ago, that it will go to referendum. I think they will do everything they can to ensure it doesn't go to referendum, because the margins at the moment from such as we have in terms of polls are very tight. Historically, the no side in European referenda tends to rise quite significantly over the course of a referendum campaign, and the consequence is that if that were to be the case, then we would have the referendum being rejected, and that would perhaps cause significant political problems for the government. I don't know what people's views are on that issue. Do they think a referendum is important? If so, should it be a referendum to amend the constitution, or should it be a referendum as a plebiscite? Surprising, Joe. I guess we do get these barren patches. What do you think, Joe? What's your feelings on it? There's a question coming from the side here about can we afford to do it. I think the issue of can we afford to do it is something that can we afford not to do it. As I said at the start, you've got a situation where one level, this is simply about good economic governance. But if you look at the implications, Konstantin Gurdjieff had some figures in last week's Sunday Times, I believe, where he suggested that this would effectively be another couple of billion a year if we were to really take it on board, that we would have to actually squeeze out of the economy over a fairly short time period, and that would be pretty tough for the economy to actually absorb. When you look at the situation where we have at the moment, what we have at the moment is a very, very bloated debt to GDP ratio. Now, that would have been high anyway, even if we hadn't taken on board the banking crisis. The intersection of the banking crisis and the intersection of the sovereign debt crisis across Europe has put Ireland in a pretty invidious situation, because we're not just having to engage with the fiscal compact as a consequence of our own overspending, which is undoubtedly there. We're also having to engage with the fiscal compact as a consequence of the, I think everybody would accept now, disastrous decision to guarantee the banks. So it's going to be a couple of decades of very hard slog that we're going to find ourselves in. George asks a question, do you think we will see stricter rules on banking regulation, enforcement, etc.? I suppose one of the weaknesses, George, which has been addressed a number of times, is that, again, in a common monetary policy, in a common monetary area, with free movement of capital, when you don't have an overarching system-wide perspective on how to deal with the originators and users of that capital, you can find very significant problems arising. I would like to think that somewhere down the line the European Central Bank would take a greater role in, at the very least, agreeing some harmonization of good practice, in perhaps finding some mechanism by which you can enforce good practice at the European level. Again, if we look at the Irish context, we see a situation where we had, on the face of it, pretty good regulations. We had good regulations about what banks could and couldn't do. It's blatantly obvious that those regulations were, at very least, laxly enforced. Do we want to have a situation where, if we're not enforcing these regulations, some other person from Frankfurt or Brussels is coming along and saying to us, hang on a second now, guys, stall the ball, you've got to do this? Politically, domestically, that's not easy to actually sell, particularly when you've got a not unjustified perception that the European Central Bank has been complicit, implicit, in foisting a lot of the banking debt onto the Irish taxpayer. So the politics of this are not easy to deal with. I'd like to see it, but I don't think we should give any leeway towards any proposals coming from Europe until such time as, at the very minimum, the promissory notes for Anglo are taken off the taxpayer. And that's something I'll be talking about to the Dáil Finance Committee next Tuesday, along with Professor Carol Whelan and Dr. Stephen Kinsella. So there's a whole pile of different pieces of the European puzzle moving together, some of which are undoubtedly in our interests, some of which are not, but the most pressing issue is we cannot proceed with this fiscal compact until, in my view, we've got the promissory notes out of the way, off the table, that we're not paying 3.1 billion per annum. That's my view. I'm not sure if it's right or popular, but I think it's defensible. What would be your feeling, George? Should we have more European banking regulation or not? So is Luxembourg. So I imagine is Lisbon. It's not obviously the case that size is an issue. I think size is important if people are, you know, too friendly and clubby with each other and can't actually take the hard decisions that sometimes you have to take in a business or regulatory environment. It's very clear that with the advent of Matthew Elderfield, in particular, somebody who doesn't have ties to the system here, somebody who, you know, in all probability will not see out their career here, who is coming here to do a job, do a very good job, and then move on to perhaps other things. He's not bound by club or, you know, tribe or family ties, and therefore is maybe a little bit freer to do things than others might feel themselves to be. So, let's see, maybe we need more of that. Yeah, the promissory notes are going to be the big battleground, and we see, frankly, conflicting noises coming out of the government at the moment, where you have Pat Rabbit saying, oh no, there's a deal and we're going to hear good news and there's going to be something nice coming out of promissory notes even as soon as in the next couple of weeks. And yet we're hearing from Michael Noonan that there's no clear proposal to actually do that. So I don't know whether or not that is going to happen or not, but hopefully it will. There is an issue as to whether or not, you know, we should actually be selling out our sovereignty, as it were, but I think that's another day's work. What about some of the quieter people? It's all George and myself here. Dennis, Edward, Fergus, what do you think? Have you got perspectives on this? Do you have questions or queries you want answered on it, or ideas you'd like to put out? Eric, what have you got on your mind about the compact? Hi, Trish. What question do you have, Trish, on this? What concerns you about the compact? What's your gut feeling on it? Do you think it's something we should do or not? Trisha must be writing a very long question there. One of the interesting issues is that we don't know how to measure a structural budget deficit or surplus. That requires several moving parts that no real consensus has emerged upon. And as a consequence, we're being asked, in a sense, to sign up for something where we don't quite know what we're being asked to measure. We don't know who's got responsibility for ensuring that it's measured correctly. We don't have any sense as to what happens when there are the inevitable disagreements between different economic modellers. We are unclear about where the power lies in terms of if the ESRI say we're in a structural budget deficit, the central banks say we're in a surplus, European Commission say we're on balance, you know, who decides and how? Not to mention the fact that, as I say, there's no evident consensus yet about how these things actually get done. So I worry about signing up to binding legal rules where it's not clear upon what basis you're going to be measured. It's a bit like saying, well, we're going to have a speed limit. And the speed limit will be a speed limit which is appropriate for the road, given the time of day and the road conditions, and that's it. And you're not told this will be determined by a police officer, this will be determined by the courts, this will be an offer between this will be a limit between 60 and 80 kilometers an hour, etc. It's very much like that. Sorry, Trish, I'm not, appreciate that, but do you have any questions, you know, that you'd like answers to? Just type in there, you've no feelings, good, bad, or indifferent on it, okay? Do you think, agree with George, that it's a political move rather than an economic move? Joe, you asked the question, what if we can't pay down the line? Well, if we can't pay, if we end up in a situation where we have a breach of the budget deficit rules, then we'll be fined. And again, this is problematic to me because if we're breaching the budget deficit rules and we're being fined, that's going to make us even more in breach of the budget deficit, which will presumably lead to further fines, which will lead to further breaches of the budget deficit. So it's a bit of a self-defeating governance structure, it strikes to me. Yeah, it would be a bit of a downward spiral, and I'm not sure that's a good idea that we want to get into. Okay. What do you think about... What do you think the bigger euro issue is that's not being addressed? George, the existence of the euro, the way in which it's managed. Can you be a bit more precise on that? I don't think there's any question that if we were to find ourselves in a post-euro environment, it would be in the short term extraordinarily disruptive for the Irish system. I've spoken at length on this before, and I've written on it. There is a genuine and appropriate debate about whether we should or should not have gone into the euro. But being in the euro now, the alternative would not be one that I would recommend. We may find fairly quickly an interesting experiment on that with Greece, because it looks as though both sides are just dead set on annoying each other to the extent that somebody will break. But, you know, that's something we'll see. But George, what is that? What is that bigger euro issue that you're concerned with? And hi, Tim. As Joe says, any questions you have, feel free to throw them in. I see Mark Coleman is sending me tweets. Mark, why don't you log in? I'm going to send him a tweet back and say he log in to the Irish debate and ask questions. As an ex-ECB official, I'm sure Mark would have some really interesting comments to make. Tim, have you got any questions, or are you just lurking as well? Do people have a concern that, and well, you lurk, sir, do you have any particular concerns that caused you to lurk here today, or are you just, like all of us, a seeker after, if not truth, at least a little bit more illumination? What are people's views on the issue of a referendum? That should we or shouldn't we have a referendum? I mean, hopefully none of us are lawyers, so we can speak with blissful ignorance of the constitutional imperatives, but it's not clear to me that they need a referendum. I think that we should have a referendum, but I'm not sure we will get one. But I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know. Do people have any concerns or issues about that? Even if it's non-binding, Tim, even if the government say, look, we don't require, the Supreme Court doesn't require us to have one, the Attorney General doesn't require us to have one, we're simply going to test the mood of the people. And what if the mood of the people is, no, we don't want this, but the government have no legal objection or no legal barrier to going ahead? Yeah, I suppose the government's argument would be, look, you know, we have a Republican rather than a direct democracy, and we elect the people who make decisions for us. You know, if the Supreme Court say there is no need, and if the Attorney General say there is no requirement, then I can't see any reason why the government would go for a referendum. I mean, I wouldn't if I was them, quite frankly. I would take this as an opportunity to make the political decision. One of the problems I think we have is that governments often don't make decisions in this country. They hide behind either their own perceived inabilities or behind the desire not to offend people. And, you know, I'm not saying push things down the line or down the throats of people, but on the other hand, you know, not everything is necessarily amenable to asking everybody all the time. It works to some extent in Switzerland, but even then, they do have a government which makes decisions. Hiya, Max. Welcome aboard. Well, I think that's a bit of an extreme statement. I don't think democracy is dying in Europe. I think there's a disconnect between the emergent federal European system and people on the ground. There are a couple of layers where that could be improved. You know, if we had a properly functioning European Parliament, if we had a Parliament that had an actual power to do things, then we might have some greater sense of involvement. But the reality is that the European budget is about 1.5% of GDP. If we want to have a parliament that has power, it's going to have power over something, and that's going to be over money, which means it's going to have a European level budget, which is 10, 15, 20 times bigger than it is now. And in that context, Ireland is going to be a small player. We are 4 million in 500. We can't have a situation where that proportion of people have vetoes. That's the difficult. You know, it would be the same as having a situation where the population of Tralee would have a veto over the parliamentary decisions of Dáil Éireann. That would not be something I think we would agree with, even those of us from Tralee. What do you think is happening worldwide, Trish, in that context? I'm not sure I follow that question. The evidence from the polls is that a significant number of people would want this. I would be in favour of the fiscal compact if it was amended to take account of some of the concerns I have, some of which are technical and some of which are more structural. But, you know, how likely... I don't know, what time is it? I mean, it seems as though every day we're in the last chance saloon. There are hard deadlines coming up for Europe. I'll come back to that, Trish, in half a sec. I'll just finish off my comment on Tim. The issue of Greece leaving the Euro, it might be that the Euro leaves Greece at the moment. They do have to make some decisions by, I think, the 15th of February, just simply technically, in order to get the bond rollover done on the 20th of March. So time is getting very short. I think the Greek situation is a classic example of the road to hell being paved with good intentions, and the consequence of successive people trying to make good decisions in the best interest of what they saw at the time have led us here. The Greek situation is not one of it's not one of liquidity, it's one of solvency. The vast amount of the Greek debts need to be written off. Somebody has to pay for those. Okay, Trish, back to you. Two questions. I'm sure there are people who want to have world domination, but, you know, I don't think... Nobody has ever achieved world domination. If they have, they haven't told us about it. And I don't think in a multipolar world, you can have world domination. Why would you like to see Ireland leave the Euro? Because... if Ireland left the Euro, if tomorrow morning we announced that we were thinking of leaving the Euro on Monday morning, the banking system would shut down instantaneously. There would not be a single penny that could move being left. We see over the last couple of weeks that large corporates are operating daily sweeps where all of the money in peripheral Eurozone countries gets taken into the UK or into the core Eurozone countries on a daily basis. Any mobile capital in the country would go. We would have interest rates ratcheting up into double-digit figures. We would have inflation ratcheting up into double-digit figures. We would still be stuck with all of the euro-denominated debt external to the country, except now it would be 20 to 25% more expensive, both in terms of its actual quantum, and it would be more expensive in terms of ability to repay. We would have to introduce currency controls. I'm old enough to remember those. We would have to have limits on the amount of money people could transmit electronically or physically. We would have a situation where there would be no money floating around for small to medium-sized enterprises because there would be no money left in the banks. So I'm sure it's not popular for a good reason. Would Greece leaving the Euro set a dangerous precedent? I think at this stage, Tim... the European situation has given up on Greece, and Greece seems to have almost given up on itself. I think it would set a precedent, but I think Greece is so badly messed up that it is in a stale, it is a case of its own. The next worst situation is probably Portugal, and that's containable. So I think compared to 6 or 12 months ago, the shock waves, while very large, would be less. Look at Greece and Italy. Again, Trish, I'm not sure what you're saying there. The parliamentary systems there allowed, I'm not saying I agree with it or like it, by the way, but the parliamentary systems there allow for the appointment of a prime minister other than through the way we would be familiar with. That, you know, in that can happen in the UK. You know, they could have, as far as I know still, a prime minister from the House of Lords who could be appointed. It's a different kind of democracy. I think not every, you know, not all democracy, well, first of all, I'm not sure, you know, that's not the case. There may be the head, the figureheads, but in the same cases in Ireland, it's the permanent government who run the country. Bradstream, missing some commentary. Joe? EU customs tourists, I think the EU have been closing up to Turkey for strategic reasons for about 1500 years, Edward, and vice versa. My personal feeling actually is that Turkey should be in the European Union. I think the best insurance of a democratic, secular, westward facing, in the best sense of the word, Turkey, which can act as a bridge into the Middle East, is that we bring it in to the acquis of the European Union. As I said at the start, the European Union is about preventing war at the end of it. And having Turkey locked in Europe, in a democratic sense, with all of the human rights requirements that would be required, would be a better situation than Turkey outside and feeling disgruntled. I think the big countries will break the regulations as and when they wish. That's the nature of what big countries do and have done. And they'll get away with it, as they did. Now, that's unpalatable, but that's realistic. France, Germany, Italy broke the Maastricht criteria with no evident negative effects. Yeah, you could put it like that. On the other hand, Germany will say that you know, they've played, generally speaking, by the rules over the last 30 years, and France is still a very powerful economic country. So the problem that we have with the new fiscal compact is that it doesn't give wiggle room. It seems not to allow for case of famine, flood, or fire, a government to engage in the kind of things we expect governments to do, which should be anti-cyclical spending. Tim, what are you basing that figure on, can I ask? Be very careful interpreting total debt figures for the Irish economy, because an awful lot of those figures that are bandied around include IFSC figures. And while IFSC, Irish Financial Services Centre banks, are resident in Ireland, the money is simply, like Father Ted, resting in their accounts, and they really are not part of the Irish economy. They could have 500% of GDP in the form of debt, and that wouldn't necessarily mean that the Irish economy was exposed to that. So I think we've got to be a little bit careful about some of those figures. What we do have is we do have very high levels of personal debt, and we do have very high levels, even allowing for the banking crisis, of government debt. And those have to be paid down, those have to be delivered. And they will be. Back in the 1980s, when I started working, we were paying 65-70% tax rates. We had 117% debt to GDP, and that was without any banking crisis. And we got out of that, okay, there were, you know, different and perhaps more benign external circumstances. So we can get out of the hole in which we're in if we can get, in my view, some relief on the promissory notes, if we can get some answers in relation to how the fiscal compact will work out in practice, and if we can get a situation where we can get a realistic and fair to all people involved the dealings with regard to personal debt. I absolutely agree, Edwards. I think, you know, this is an austerity compact as it stands, and I've said that a number of times, and I think it's not a good idea. I would think that a overarching approach towards greater harmonization of national versus central policies in relation to expenditure, which we're having, taxation, which we're not having, and transfers, which we're not having, would be a better approach. My concern is that if we get this austerity element, we won't have any incentive as a polity, as a European, as a national polity, to move towards discussions of the taxation and welfare elements. So, you know, are we in the danger of wasting this crisis, I would think. The other point, I suppose, Edward, I'd make is that we've got probably four or five economies in the country. You've got the domestic SME economy. You've got the SME sector that is external facing. You've got the public sector. You've got the multinational sector. So they all have different elements. Well, I disagree with you, Edward. I think the promissory notes should be written off. I mean, think of what promissory notes are. Promissory notes are basically the counterparty to the money which was created by the Central Bank of Ireland to reflate Anglo-Irish Bank, to pay off the bondholders of Anglo-Irish Bank. There's a reason why the ECB is not happy with the idea of that money staying as a permanent increase in the money base, and that's because if we do it, then what's to stop other countries from doing it? And that would lead to a very large, perhaps, increase in money, which would result, perhaps, in inflation down the line. So, you know, there's a lot of perhapses and maybes there, but that's the chain of logic that they're discussing. Now, I don't see that as a problem. I think we are so far away in Europe from any danger of hyperinflation that there's no issue from the Irish context. And the Irish banks are amongst the worst in the European system. Unfortunately, Trish, as Martin Kelly said, we're at the kindness of strangers. I don't like the idea of cutting social welfare. I don't like the idea of cutting wages. I don't like the idea of austerity. But even if we had no banking crisis, we would be 13 to 15 billion in the hole per annum. How do we fix that? I'm asking you, how do we fix that? I don't know. I know we can't do it overnight. I know there is no magic pot of wealth at the end of the rainbow. If you look at some of the figures coming out of Seamus Coffey's excellent blog, Economic Incentives, he goes through the data that we have on wealth in the country. The French managed to get about 1% of their total tax take from a wealth tax. And some of the figures coming out of the United Left Alliance here are implying we might get 7.5-10%. Can we really are we really 10%, 10 times more wealthy than France? Can we really get 10 times more out of our wealth than France? That pot of gold doesn't exist at the end of a non-existent rainbow. So unfortunately, it's a slow grind. It's going to be a slow grind of cutting expenditure, and I agree, don't cut it at the weakest until we get to the really nth degree of problems, increasing the tax base, and trying to grow the economy. Now, we have been doing the first two, but we're not doing the third, we're not doing the third because the government doesn't have any cash. It doesn't have any cash because Proximo, the previous government, blew it all on guaranteeing the banks. Other questions? Hiya, Snowdy. How are you? Yeah, one of the interesting things, you're absolutely spot on there to raise the danger, which the fiscal compact nor anything else has hinted at. There's no doubt that foreign direct investment has been extraordinarily useful and has been the engine of growth for the Irish economy for many, many years. And you can say, oh, a lot of that is simply tax based and a lot of that is simply transfer payments. I'm sure it is. But there are still hundreds of thousands of jobs directly and indirectly resulting from the foreign direct investment, much of which is US based. We are very exposed on our export base. Our export base is very heavily dependent on a small number of pharma and chemical companies in particular. And if there is something outside our control, such as the US tax system, which could result in it becoming attractive to move back, then we would be in problems. I still think there are good reasons why multinationals and would come to Ireland. And if you look at the real Celtic Tiger era, which was 95, 96 to about 2001, a relatively cheap, well-educated, flexible labor force with good quality for the time infrastructure was what attracted people. And we need to get back to that and the old-fashioned business of making things and services that people want. Manufacturing is great, and I think we should have more manufacturing, but we're not good historically at manufacturing. We're good at talking, we're good at communications, we're good at interpersonal services, we're good at mediation, we're good at things other than metal bashing because we have a history of not doing that. So, yeah, by all means, let's build up manufacturing at the high end, but we're not going to be able to out-manufacture China or India. We can out-plum Austin. We can out-negotiate in some senses. If you look around, you've got lots and lots of Irish people in lots of sensitive positions, two and three and four levels down from the top, who are making things work, who are smoothing the way. We're good at that. Let's not be ashamed of it. I think, Trish, we are. It's just that the cattle are indoors for the most part at the moment. I know my brother-in-law has his cattle in the sheds, and the sheep, well, sheep are probably dying in a ditch that they've seen 10 times that minute because they're stupid. We are producing lots of food. We could produce more. What we can't do, though, Trish, is we can't, on one hand, say we want to have high quality organic grass-fed beef, and on the other hand, say we want to outperform Holland, where the cattle never see the light of day. It's about value versus quantity, and we need to consider whether or not we want to do quantity or value based. Can we not stop guarantees to banks now as they seem to be depositing the cash in the ECB? Well, here's a question. There's two guarantees. There's two guarantees going on. There's a guarantee on deposits, and there's a guarantee on debt, which the banks issue. I think we need to consider whether or not the debt on government, sorry, the government guarantee on issuing debt by the banks, is there a better way to ensure the banks can get access to the necessary financing? I'm not sure that the time is yet there, that the confidence is there in the Irish banking system to withdraw those guarantees in where we are. Whether they should have been put in place or not is another question. How come government current spending? Well, a lot of the current government spending is creeping up because of the fact that we have very large numbers of people unemployed and on welfare, and we have to pay people who are on welfare rates. That's a big part of it. Another large part of it is the fact that we have a system still whereby there are automatic increments in public sector pay, including my own, regardless of whether one turns up for work and does a good job or not. And I certainly think that that's not an ideal way to manage any business or any organization. You pay people more if they do better quality, you pay them less if they do less quality, and you try to improve their quality. ECB's actions. Yeah, I agree there, Edward. And I think the fiscal compact goes back into this. It has pandered to the needs of Germany in particular about inflation, and that's driving, for example, in my view, the decision about the promissory notes. And I don't think the Commission, I don't think that the fiscal compact is going to do anything other than that. Those of us who are old enough to remember the heyday of Thatcherism will remember that, you know, she was a great fan of the Lincolnshire housewife. That the Lincolnshire housewife would run her shop, run her house in a very sensible manner. And Herr Dr. Merkel, or Frau Dr. Merkel, to give her a title, Frau Dr. and Professor Merkel, is a great fan of the Swabian housewife, that, you know, the economics of the Swabian housewife. Countries aren't houses, countries aren't businesses, and people far too easily say, oh, well, bring in, you know, X, Y, or Z business person and run the country like that. Well, that's not a country, that's a commercial entity, and countries aren't commercial entities. That said, when you have a common monetary policy, you need to have a common fiscal policy. We're now seeing that. That was very clear at the time. The argument was that will come. The argument was people will act in a sensible manner. And they didn't. So that's it. Imported energy. Yeah, no, look, I've no idea. I've no idea how we deal with that. I agree. I think that our shibboleth about all forms of things nuclear needs to be got rid of. Although people did point out to me, you know, if we'd had a nuclear power plant in Carnsore, the same kind of regulations that led to Anglo-Irish Bank, the same kind of regulatory practices would have been put in place with regard to the nuclear power plant. So maybe it's a good job we didn't. But there are new forms of nuclear systems, pebble bed reactors, thorium reactors. I think we need to consider all forms of getting rid of our dependence on external imported energy. And we have, you know, if we could harness the rain, there's no doubt we'd be exporting energy. But that's not addressed in the fiscal compact. And I don't think the governments of Europe are going to have the money to invest. One of the issues that is there is, if you look at the figures, and Carl Whelan has done some analyses on this, the implication of the fiscal compact is that the European sovereign debt pool will shrink by about 6 trillion euro over the course of the fiscal compact. And that is an enormous amount of money to take out of a system. 6 trillion euro of a shrinkage is not going to leave an awful lot of safe or safe-ish assets for pension funds or investment funds to use as a basis for basically backstopping more risky. People so happy with no to raise. I suppose I'm more trouble than it's worth. Basically, it requires us a sickly budget surplus. Put forward in a taxation. Not some figure suggests activities. Get back about what? Moment. So, pretty much, and take some time. So, you know, I'm here to ask questions. Different economics cycle, different. We're going towards much greater involvement. Now, transfer. Is your question? What's your feeling, George? Do you think this is better or indifferent? Please. What about European instruments? Criteria we will through budget. So with the new proposed fiscal compact, that we in the ship of state on the rocks.